I'll share with you now some of the background story that led me to create a website called Rest Stop Ranch. As I share with you my story, I ask that you please keep in mind the 15 million caregivers in America now who have this type of similar story. They're living it right now. And if you know of any caregivers in your life, please share the resources that I'm developing with them. So, this is a photo of me and my mom in 2008. It's about 6 months before she passed away. She was 66, 67 years old. Four years ago, in 2007, I was 35 years old. I was an educated, successful young adult living in the greater Boston area. Big companies hired me to make their websites friendly and easy to use. I made a six-figure salary and rented a fabulous apartment. I was contributing regularly to a 401k. I had a great group of friends. I had finally made it as an adult. And life was good, except for the fact that my mom had been diagnosed with a frontotemporal degenerative brain illness the year before, commonly referred to as FTD. While working 70 hours a week at Fidelity as a lead designer, I had helped coordinate the many appointments required to arrive at this diagnosis. It was a difficult process and it was heartbreaking. My mom was a funny, smart, generous 66-year-old woman. How could she be dying? I couldn't believe it. I regularly traveled back home to New York State to check on her status. Friends, family, and healthcare professionals said to me, "Now, Mary, make sure you take care of yourself. This is going to be long and hard." And I said, "Well, okay." I had no idea what I was getting myself into. In September of 2007, Mom's symptoms became worse, and it was clear I would have to return to New York State and manage her care at home. It was as if a tornado picked me up from Marlborough, Massachusetts, and dropped me right at the kitchen table, north of Syracuse, New York. I had to pack up everything in my life. My business suits, my favorite books, my everything. I had to pack it up and put it into storage, not knowing how long am I going to be here in New York State at the kitchen table, hiring, managing three shifts of care workers for this illness, which I have no idea how long it's going to last. So I literally had basically two pairs of jeans and a couple of shirts and a couple of extra things in my bag and my car and my iPhone. And it was basically this outfit and multiple bags in the backseat of my car that I lived out of for 14 months. If I needed my favorite sweatshirt, I had to go to Walmart and buy it again. I could no longer meet my friends or keep my own medical or dental appointments. I was no longer a lead designer at a major financial company. I was a family care manager for my mom, who suffered major physical and mental losses every 2 weeks. Together, we had entered a desert experience. Her illness was unpredictable, disorienting, and incredibly stressful. I regularly had to excuse myself from the situation, go in to the bathroom or the guest room, and simply say, rest, stop, breathe. And that would reset my system for about 5 minutes, and then I could return to the caregiving situation. In January of 2008, Mom broke an ankle, and she could no longer stay at her home. We moved her to an assisted living community in Boston. She hated being away from her house. And I can just tell you that was devastating to me also. Over the course of the year, she experienced life in 2 assisted living communities, 5 hospital visits, and 1 nursing home. It was an awful decline, and I was with her every step of the way. Halfway through that year, I had a panic attack. Now, for those of you who are unfamiliar with panic attacks, they can be very scary. I was taking an evening class, and midway through the class, found it difficult to breathe. I felt as though my lungs were literally constricted. I had to excuse myself from the class I was in and go out to the parking lot. I sat in my car and I said, okay, is this going to stop? And it didn't. It just continued to feel like I could barely breathe. I really panicked and I called Carl, my partner, on my phone and said, hey, this is what's happening to me. I'm freaking out. I don't even know if I can get home. Carl said, take a deep breath, Mare. Take several deep breaths. Continue breathing deeply. You're going to be okay, and you're going to get home. Call me if you need any additional support. I started up my car, and I did use the deep breathing as I was driving 495 back to my mother-in-law's house, where I was staying on the couch at the time. It worked for me, and I did get home safely. This was the first time I realized maybe I don't know how to take care of myself. It was the first time I ever had reason to visit a psychiatrist. The doctor explained that the chronic stress I had been under for several months caused my brain to be overloaded to the point it was no longer able to handle stress in a regular way. Therefore, it caused the panic attack. I asked her, well, what can I do so this doesn't happen again? And she then made out 2 scripts for me, 1 for an antidepressant and 1 for an anti-anxiety. And I had read a lot about these medicines And I asked her, I said, you know, I've read a lot about these medicines, and I know that some of these medicines can reduce my quality of life even further. Isn't there an alternative? And then she said, well, you can go to talk therapy. And I just said, wow, I've come to the expert on chronic stress in our medical system and how I should be handling this. And my options are either to take medicines that will have the potential to reduce my pleasure in life, or to sit in the counselor's office and tell her how stressed out I am. And something needs to change here. So I went into my own bubble and I said, you know, Mary, you don't need to take those medicines and you don't need to talk to a talk therapist because you can't even show up to the appointments. What you need is you need a break. You need a vacation. You need to rest and stop. You need not to keep taking crisis phone calls about your mom's situation. You need not to continue driving I-90 miles and miles back and forth to New York State, because my father still lived in New York State, and Boston. You need not to do any of that. You need to sit on your mother-in-law's back porch. You need to watch the Merrimack River go by. You need to play the piano whenever you feel like it. You need to buy some fashion magazines and enjoy the fashion photos. You need to breathe. You need to rest. That's what you need. So I did that. And doing so enabled me to reset my entire nervous system well enough so that I could journey with my mom through her end of life, which was about 4 months. She passed away Christmas Eve, 2008. I felt like a part of me died with her. I couldn't believe the illness had nearly an equally devastating effect on me as it had had on her. My partner Carl and I moved to Topsfield 2 months later. I called the new home Rest Stop Ranch. The only part of me that felt like it still worked was my breathing in and out, in and out. I watched as my belly expanded and contracted. I realized this is the spirit in me that is breathing me. I'm not in control here. This fragile life is reduced to one thing, the breath that enlivens us. I realized that I had been kept alive. I had survived this experience. I was completely numb and remained in shock for most of 2009. I spent a lot of days asleep on the couch watching HGTV.